Why am I getting these notifications allowed now? Didn't get them before. Okay. Using literary theory in research and literature, that's what we're going to do today. In today's session, we're going to talk about how literary theory should be used in research, how to choose a literary theory, and how to use it in a research study in literature. We've talked about this before. I made this picture, so I was very excited to show it to you guys. I made it for a lecture, and I was like, oh, that looks nice. So yeah, so types of research, empirical and non-empirical. Within empirical, we have qualitative and quantitative. And you can see I've put in a lot of effort in those pictures, so I would really like you to notice them. Qualitative has why and how in it, and quantitative has numbers in it. Non-empirical research has got textual analysis with it. Okay. Now, empirical versus non-empirical research, just a quick recap. I would like you to go through the slide, please. So empirical research is the one in which we collect data, and non-empirical is the one in which we do not collect data. Usually research in humanities, in arts, like philosophical research, research in fine arts, research in literature, those are done under non-empirical research because we do not collect data. We either solve a philosophical question by thinking, or we analyze a literary or artistic piece. So those kind of research are non-empirical. Qualitative and quantitative, we have talked about this before. Quantitative data is a structured numerical data that can be put into a spreadsheet and analyzed with a statistical method. Okay? That's the kind of research that's very uncommon in literature. We literature students are usually not very good with mathematics. We don't do maths a lot. So we try and avoid statistics as well. Qualitative research is something that is increasingly being done in studies in literature, especially related to teaching of literature or perceptions related to literary pieces. So qualitative research, what is it? Qualitative data is unstructured information from focus group comments, observations, etc., that is summarized subjectively as opposed to mathematically. So in qualitative research, a lot of our perceptions as a researcher are involved, okay? That much is clear to everybody, right? We already know those things. Quick responses in the chat, please. Clear, Isra, Salman, okay. Okay, all right, let's move on. Now, defining textual analysis. When we perform textual analysis on a text, we make an educated guess at some of the most likely interpretations that might be made of the text. Does this make sense to you? What do you understand from it? Could somebody write it in their own words? Or you could turn on the mic and speak as well. That's also fine. Feel free to take a minute to think about it. Okay, all right. A little bit more detail. Textual analysis is presenting the possible interpretation of the text. At cursory look, one has to decide which theory can be applied on the given text, kind of an educated guess. Okay. Why cursory look, Imran? Cursory is rather superficial, isn't it? Okay, so as I had said before, that, yes, Selma, that's right. As I had said to you before, that there are two types of textual analysis, one in social sciences when the text is taken as data, and the second one in literary studies when text is analyzed in the light of theory. When we consider text as data, we analyze it qualitatively. And qualitative data analysis class, I will explain the systematic procedure that we follow to analyze a qualitative data. Whereas in literary study, when we analyze a text, we read it in the perspective of a theory. So we don't have a proper procedure to follow, and we don't treat the text as data. First is qualitative and empirical. So if somebody tells you that textual analysis is qualitative, please tell them that you're not doing that kind of textual analysis. You're doing the non-empirical kind of textual analysis, because that's the one that's done in literature. Let me give you some examples. So the first one, the example of a textual analysis in literary study, is when you study elements of existentialism in Waiting for Godot, when you study feminism in Wuthering Heights, you study romanticism in Ode to the Nightingale. However, textual analysis in social science is the one where you are analyzing, say, gender in Sindhi textbook. So in that case, like we discussed in qualitative data collection class on interviews, that you will write a transcript of your interview, right? So once you have the transcript, what we do in analysis is we code that data. So we take out each and every statement and we give it a topic, all right? Once we have done that, we put those codes into groups, and then we put those in our findings. We write about them. However, when we are analyzing a text in literary research, we do not do that. We don't do a qualitative data analysis. We don't name our data, okay? So a qualitative data analysis is guided by theory. Whereas a textual analysis in literature is guided by theory, sorry. Yes, Halima, sure. There would be no data. In non-empirical studies, there is no data, okay? Non-empirical research does not get any data. So we do not have any data in that research. What I just said, Halimat, I'll repeat it for you. What I was saying was that when you're doing an analysis of a textbook, you treat the written text like an interview transcript, and you analyze it qualitatively. You treat that as your data, and you code it. What's coding? Coding is naming the data. And we'll talk about that in qualitative data analysis class in more detail. So you code the data, you put it into categories, and then you write about those in your findings. However, we do not do that in non-empirical textual analysis. In non-empirical textual analysis, we do not have any data. All we have is a literary text, and we want to look at it through the lens of a theory. Any lens that you take, whether it's feminism, Marxism, you take that lens and you try and look at the text from that perspective. Okay, so in today's class, we are going to focus on that textual analysis, the literary textual analysis. Okay, does that make sense? We're not really concerned with the second kind. Our concern is with the first one. So textual analysis in literature. In literature, taking a text and applying a critical theory to it is considered textual analysis, right? A text could be anything from different genres. It could be a poem, it could be a short story, a novel, a play, an essay, anything is a text. So if you're taking Bacon's essays, or if you're taking Keats' poetry, or you're taking Pride and Prejudice, the novel, or you're taking a short story, that's all what I'm calling a text, okay? So whatever text you take, whichever genre you take it from, that's completely okay. And you can still apply a critical theory to it. A critical theory needs to be chosen in accordance with the themes and content of the text of your choice. Like we were discussing before, that when you look at the text, you read certain theories and you decide on which one you're going to use, and then you analyze that text with relevance to that theory. Does that make sense? Means at one point our text is interpreted by the theories, and another text is only data we use in our research. We use this text according to our relevant topics. Who's that? Nimra. Yes, Nimra, you're right. Okay, moving on. It will be a little bit more clearer with examples. So we'll talk about that in a bit as well. What does applying theory mean? So I keep saying you need to apply a theory. What does that mean? Application of theory means looking at a literary text from the perspective of a literary theory, like feminism, post-colonialism, Marxism, all these theoretical approaches that we have. Since you have discussed feminism and Marxism, you would have some idea of those approaches. So what we do as a researcher is we read the theory and we select its key features or elements. So what are the key features of feminism? If I take Virginia Woolf's concept of feminism, she talks about social rights and economical rights for women and men equally, right? Equal rights for men and women from a social perspective and from an economic perspective. So these are two key elements of her theory. So when you read a theory, you have to decide which features in that theory are important, and you need to take those out. You need to select those elements. And then we observe those elements within a piece of work, okay? For example, have you read The Reluctant Fundamentalist by Mohsin Hamid? Has anyone read it? Okay, Imran has read it. Who else? It's a very interesting work, written in the backdrop of 9/11 incident. It's very famous as well. So it might be worth reading. So if your topic is post-colonialism in Mohsin Hamid's selected work, then I could select Bhabha's theory of post-colonialism, right? Homi K. Bhabha gives a theory of post-colonialism. He's an Indian theorist who talks about hybrid identity and identity crisis. So I take that as one key element in Bhabha's post-colonial theory. So I select the element of identity crisis from post-colonial theory of Homi K. Bhabha, and I will look for issues related to identity crisis in Mohsin Hamid's Reluctant Fundamentalist. Okay? Reluctant Fundamentalist is the story of this Pakistani young man, Chengiz, who lives in New York and adopts the American ways and has completely mixed up in that culture. He has an American girlfriend, and he has a lot of friends there, and he has built a whole life there. But as soon as 9/11 happens, people start looking at him differently. and he starts thinking of himself differently. He goes through an identity crisis. So that is why this theory is very relevant to that work. Okay. Moving on, how to choose a theory. We know that we need to select the theory based on our choice and interest. We will select the literary text based on our choice and interest. But how do you choose a theory? That's a difficult thing, right? Especially Imran and Nimra, your questions are very related to each other. I'll answer this after this slide. How do you choose a theory? You read literary theory books like Tyson. The image is given here and the book is shared on your group. I think, yes, I have shared it on your group. Literary theory book by Tyson, Critical Theory Today. It's a very basic book of literary theory. It's a textbook which can help develop an understanding of the different theories. So if you want some basic reading of feminism, reader response theory, Marxism, post-colonialism, it has got chapters on all of these theories written in very easy language, and we are able to follow it. So Tyson is one book that you could look at. However, there are others. There are a lot of others, like this Cambridge Companion to Literary Critical Theory. There are special theory books on feminism and post-colonialism separately as well. What you need to do is you should have some basic idea of key theories like Marxism, feminism, post-colonialism, structuralism, deconstruction, let's say. And you judge the need of that theory from the elements of the text. So your familiarity with the text is very important. You cannot choose a theory that has no relevance to the text. Say, for example, if I chose Marxism in Lord of the Flies. Now, there is not much content to explore Marxism in Lord of the Flies. Lord of the Flies is a story of a group of kids stranded on an island, and you could apply a lot of theories to it, but Marxism probably may not be a suitable theory. So your understanding of the text is very important. If the theory is not relevant at all, then that could be problematic, right? For example, I've given an example here. Austen's work, Pride and Prejudice, talks about class system as well as represents women. So you could either apply feminism or Marxism to the study of this novel, right? So you have to find some relevance of the theory to the text. It's very important. For that, you need some understanding of the text as well as some understanding of the theory. Now, Imran's question is that do we need to apply just one element, or is it possible to apply all the elements of the theory? Both ways it's possible. Okay. So if you choose to select one or two elements, if you choose to select three elements of the theory that you feel are relevant to your work, that's okay. If you feel that all elements of the theory are relevant to your work, that's also fine. Okay. Nimra and Imran, are both your questions answered now? No, you have to give a justification of why you chose certain elements. And a good justification is only when those elements were not relevant, right? So you choose to drop off certain elements, then you have to give a justification for it in your methodology and the only good justification is that they were not relevant to your study. Okay, so that way your analysis will not be I don't really know what the word spurious means, but I think it means one-sided or biased. Yeah, is that what you mean? Okay. Does that answer your question as well? Nimra, you can turn on your mic and ask the question if you want to. Nimra, I'm waiting for you. Can we apply more than one theory to our text, like you say, feminism and Marxism? I meant you can apply both of them, but I don't mean you would apply them simultaneously. People do that in PhD level research. They apply more than one theoretical frameworks. But at your level, no, let's not do that. One theory is enough. Okay? It is possible to apply more than one theory, but you shouldn't do that. Okay. All right, let's go through this abstract. It's an example abstract of a paper, research paper, where a theory was applied to a literary text. Okay, please go through it and see if you follow. Nimra, if it's not relevant to your work, then you shouldn't choose it. Then you should change that, change your theory. Okay. Zahar, your mic keeps getting unmuted. Could you please not do that? Oh, that's great. Yes, exactly. You should know more. Let me know when you have read the abstract. Are we done reading? Did we understand it? Sarshta, did you follow what is being, how theory is being applied here? Why is it two people from the same ID, Sajda 65 or Nusrat 57? Who is it? How is it that the two of you are logged in through the same device? Yes, that's right. Laughter theory is applied here. Yes, exactly, Faiza. Finding laughter theory in Samuel Beckett's work. Okay, all right. You're from the same class? You're both from final year, right? So it's not a regular laughter, right? It's not the kind of laughter that we have on jokes or when we laugh at each other in happiness and merriment. That's not the kind of laughter that Beckettian characters had. It was a strange kind of laughter. It was almost filled with horror, right? It was a strange laughter that did not invoke laughter in the audience. And if the audience ever laughed at it, it seemed improper. It seemed like we were being immoral by laughing at the condition of the characters, even though they were laughing themselves. So that's the kind of gothic laughter that the author is talking about here. The laughter theory talks about the implications of strange laughters. And that's the theory that has been applied to the Beckettian work, to Waiting for Godot, and to other works by Beckett as well. Another example abstract, a textual analysis of the Chorus Small Things. Let's take a look. Please go through it. Let me know when you're done reading. All right, Ethazas, could you turn on your mic and speak and tell us what the abstract is about? Which is the text being used and which theory? Which text is being used here? Yeah, sure, Ethazas, go ahead.
Assalamu alaikum, ma'am.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Ma'am, this is abstract belongs to The God of Small Things by Arundhati Roy.
Mm-hmm.
And that to analyze the citizenship perspective by using the Kogan theory.
Okay.
And where the researcher want to find out the duties, right, and identities. That is a citizenship perspective in the novel, The God of Small Things.
Exactly. Exactly. Yes. Thank you. All right. So the text being used here is The God of Small Things. And the framework used is citizenship by Kogan. And the model is Kogan, and the elements are identity, rights, and duties. Okay. Yes, Parvisha, that's right. Okay, let's move on. So what are the steps in applying a theory? What exactly needs to be done? Sure, Imran. Imran, could you please clarify what's not clear? Sorry.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, Imran.
Actually, the term citizenship is kind of confusing term. Like rights and duty is clear.
Mm-hmm.
Citizenship, I don't understand why the term citizenship is being incorporated in this text. Citizenship is something else, that something that defined by constitution. So in this
citizenship studies is a subject, right? Citizenship education is a subject that's taught in a lot of countries. It's equivalent to our social studies. So citizenship, even though that term citizenship is like I'm a Pakistani citizen and somebody else might be an American citizen, that kind of citizenship is something different. But this citizenship is the art of living in society, right? Citizenship education is the education of telling people how to live in society. So when they live in society, they have certain rights, they have certain duties, and they have a status, they have an identity. And that is why Kogan has defined citizenship in terms of identity, rights, and duties. He says that citizenship has these five elements. He basically gives five elements, but the researcher has used three. So a lot of people say that citizenship can be defined in terms of identity, rights, and duties. So if you are a citizen of a country, you have a status, you have certain responsibilities, and you get certain privileges in return. So that's what constitutes your being a citizen. Does that make sense? All right, great. Moving on. Yes, applying theory to a text. There are certain steps to applying theory to a text. These are not steps that are written in a book. These are steps that I have created for ease of my students, okay? So as novice researchers, as new researchers, sometimes you need a protocol to follow. A list of steps to follow, and that is why I have given these steps. First one is selecting a text. You select a text in which you are interested in, all right? It's very important that you should know the text well before selecting it, because that will help you in your choice of research questions and literary theory. then based on the themes of the selected text, decide which theory can be applied. Okay, so every theory has its different elements, and not each theory is suitable for each text. Like in Waiting for Godot, you can apply existentialism, but you cannot apply post-colonialism on Waiting for Godot. It's an earlier text. It's written by an English author, a European author, and it's based in that context. So you cannot apply post-colonialism. So you have to have some knowledge of the text to be able to choose a theory. So you read and choose a literary theory. Yes, you need to read about theories, and a basic book like Tyson can help you in that way. Identify one key theorist. Now, it's not about saying that I'm going to apply feminism or I'm going to apply post-colonialism. Within those, there are a lot of different models. There are different versions, let's say, right? So feminism is given by Virginia Woolf, Simone de Beauvoir, Showalter. There are so many different people who have given different theories of feminism. So whose model of feminism are you going to use? You need to select one, okay? So that's the third step. Identify one key theorist. Then identify elements of the theory. The theoretical model that you have selected now needs to be read in detail. So at the second step, you just chose a theory based on your basic knowledge of it. But once you've decided which theory you want to use and which theorist you want to use, you need to read that in detail. So if you're saying you're going to read, you're going to apply Virginia Woolf's model of feminism, then you need to read Virginia Woolf's model of feminism in detail. And you need to identify some key features and elements of that theory. So you read Virginia Woolf's model of feminism, and you realize that she talks about social rights and economical rights, and you chose those two elements to be applied to your text, okay? So you need to identify the elements. What do you do after you've identified the elements? The fifth step is closely reading a text in light of the elements. What exactly would you do? You would read the text very closely, like each and every line, okay? To see if and how these elements of the theory are presented in it. Since we chose the theory based on our text, we are hoping that these elements will be present, but how are they present? To what level? In which incidents? In which characters? How exactly does the writer deal with those elements? So how has the writer talked about social rights? How has the writer talked about the economic rights of women? And how is it presented throughout the work? When you're reading it, you can underline it, you can make tables, you can make a list for better organization of ideas, right? So once you're reading it, you find social rights, you underline that in green. You find economic rights, you underline that in yellow. And then throughout the book, you find those underlines, and then you make a list out of it. This will help you organize, because we cannot just remember everything at the end of a novel. If you have a novel, it will be a long text. So organizing your ideas in some way or the other will help. Then the last element is writing an analysis in light of the elements identified. So you saw that social economic list rights are there. You have a list, and now you should start writing how each element is presented in the text of your choice. This is the six-step guide to doing a textual analysis. Okay, I'll give you an example for each step. Let's see. Are you guys reading The God of Small Things? Are you familiar with the text? Yes, you've done it? Okay, that's great. Great. So if we select Arundhati Roy's The God of Small Things, that would be our first step. The second step would be, based on the themes of the novel, I feel I can apply Marxism as there is class depiction in the novel. So I've read the text and I have chosen a theory. I want to apply Marxism. Now I have to identify one key theorist. I cannot say I am applying Marxism and that wouldn't be enough. There are different people who have given Marxist literary theories. So I choose Althusser's model of Marxism. Althusser has given a theory of Marxism that's applied in literary texts. So I want to select that. Identifying elements of the theory. Now reading Althusser, I observe that there are three levels of analysis that can be done. Althusser talks about economic, political, and ideological rights or differences. So closely reading a text in the light of those elements, I read the novel and highlight economic, political, and ideological discussions in three different colors. And then in the last step, writing an analysis in the light of the elements identified, I then write my analysis of the novel in the light of Althusser's model. Sample is shared on the next slide. Let's take a look. Please go through it. This is Althusser's Marxism in The God of Small Things. It's an extract from a larger text, okay? Please go through it. I'll answer your question in a bit, Imran. I think everybody might benefit from that. Are we done reading? Does that make sense? Is it clear? Does it need any explanation? All right, that's great. So that's how you would write an analysis, okay? So that's the way that you're supposed to be writing your analysis in response to a text. Okay, so Imran's got a question. He's asking that why do we need to select one model? Why is it not possible to apply a theory in general? Now, if you apply a theory in general, then it's your idea of that theory, right? So it's not based on referenceable material, okay? If you're saying I'm applying feminism and I'm not choosing any model of feminism, then it's your model of feminism, but you're not a theorist, right? So your model of feminism is not very authentic. That is why we do not choose a theory in general. We try and stick to one or the other model because it helps us give a sound foundation to our work. Does that make sense? Yes, exactly. So it will not really be a good research work if it was just based on your ideas and not based on some published material, okay? Yes, but it's not very good to do that. There are people who have done it, and there must be work that has done those kind of things, but it shouldn't be that way. Let's take a look at another example. Post-colonialism in A Passage to India. So A Passage to India is a novel by E.M. Forster written in pre-partition times. It was an age of colonialism, but Forster shows a lot of elements that are post-colonial in nature. So we choose the theory of post-colonialism, and we choose the theorist Homi K. Bhabha, and we choose his elements of hybridity and mimicry. Hybridity says that we post-colonial people like us, Pakistanis are post-colonial, right? So our identity is mixed. So we have got some elements of our own culture and some elements of our colonial powers within us, and our hybrid, our identity now has become a very hybrid identity. Somebody's mic is on, Essen. Okay. Bhabha also says that we try and copy the colonial power, we mimic. So mimicry is also an element of post-colonialism, Bhabha's post-colonialism. So we identify the elements in the text, and then we write about it. So Aziz, with his British education, Aziz is the main character in the novel Passage to India. With his British education, an Indian Muslim identity is an example of hybridity. He uses collar studs to keep his collar straight. It's like cufflinks, but for collars. Less common now, but used to be very common in 19th century. So, 20th century. Using a collar stud to keep his collar straight is the Indian man trying to mimic the English. So the elements of hybridity and mimicry both are present in the novel Passage to India. All right. Does that make sense? One thing that we should all know is that you need to acknowledge all authors of all publications. You cannot copy word for word what an author has said. You need to analyze and rewrite. Because if you don't do that, that is considered plagiarism, okay? If you take somebody's words, you need to give a reference. If you take somebody's idea, you need to give a reference, okay? If you absolutely have to quote another author word to word, then make sure that you use quotation marks, you give page numbers and the reference, okay? So plagiarism is something that needs to be taken very seriously when you're doing a research work. As I have said before, we can put your documents in Turnitin. Turnitin is the software where you can actually match the text against all internet databases. So we get a match and we are able to see where you have taken different extracts from. So please try and get into the practice of putting ideas in your own words rather than copying word for word from other sources. And also get in the habit of putting a reference in your notes. So whenever you're taking notes, put a reference there so that it's clearer to you later that this is what I did. Okay, this is where I took it from. So you have a reference. All right, let me check if that is the last slide. Yes. That's it. Do we have any questions or comments? Since I'm taking the next class as well, I thought I would finish this one early so I get some rest in the middle. All right. I hope that textual analysis is clear to everybody. Do we have any questions? Anything that is unclear? Do you think you would be able to do a research based on textual analysis now? You would, of course, have to do a lot of reading, but do you have the right skills to do it now? Do you know how to do it? It's almost